reverberated in different ways through all of the papers and panels today. And Paul's paper, I really recommend you reading. It's in the journal because he is also addressing that issue about not only the difficulty of engaging in debates on this topic in our beloved discipline, but he gets that the emotional piece a little bit in an interesting way, because he talks about how, you know, Josh Glasgow has written some stuff on the science of race, and Paul wanted to, Paul knew that there was a problem with Glasgow's account and wanted to address it, but he just didn't want to go there. You know, he just didn't want to go there. So he theorizes what that's like for many of us often, of not wanting to have to go to the debate on the terrain that somebody else has framed with their terms and their concepts in a way that ignores the way it has been framed elsewhere. So it is work that in some level needs to happen, right, where we engage with the mainstream in effect, but it has a double layer of work that it requires of us. There's an emotional piece to it as well as a theoretical piece to it, and he speaks to it really nice. For me, he speaks to it, he speaks to these issues really well in the essay. So this is what I'm going to talk about too. Just as women's studies scholars discovered more than a generation ago that one cannot simply add women in STIR as a way to introduce scholarship and research on women in the academy, one cannot simply add race and STIR to the existing field of philosophy. Though I am aware in saying what I'm about to say, that comparing oppression to the fool's game, in some respects, I want to suggest here that the problems of race are even more intransigent. If, as Genevieve Lloyd wrote back in 1984, that feminism required and still requires attending to the other of reason, the objective realm of bodies, desires, and particularities of our affective commitments, critical race theory requires attending to the colonial context. The context, in other words, in which our revered canon of rational thought has been and continues to be produced. Putting philosophy in its context requires working from and within the decolonial studies that are now emerging in geography, history, anthropology, sociology, that is, the assortment of derided social sciences that too many philosophers from all persuasions have summarily ignored. If some thought that feminist philosophy could at least stay within the realm of theory, high theory, psychoanalytic theory, and post-structuralist and critical theory, this is not going to work for the work of critical race philosophy. Eurocentric theory is going to be called out, and worse, put in context as a limited, partial, even somewhat delusional perspective, and not the underlying key to the riddle. There's much that philosophy does not know that it does not know. The epistemology of ignorance, we might say, begins at home. So I want to talk about this issue in regard to two topics in my time allotted here. First, in regard to what some are calling the geography of epistemology, or the shifting the geography of reason. And second, in regard to whiteness and white identity, which is the implicit but also visible perspective of philosophy. European philosophy that here, and then it simply must open the doors and make way for other perspectives or make a space for other philosophical traditions alongside itself, to the side, if not to the back. Here's how Walter Mignolo puts his point. He says, quote, "The important observation to make here is not simply whether there are other perspectives about the same event, but that an other paradigm emerges across the epistemic colonial difference. The dominant theo and ego politics is being contested by the emerging shift to the geopolitics and body politics of knowledge produced from the geohistorical and biohistorical perspective of racialized locations and peoples." Unquote. So in other words, this is no add alongside or happy multiculturalism. Let me take a moment here to unpack just briefly Mignolo's argument. I think what Mignolo means to refer to when he talks about theopolitics came up in the first session when the issue of Christian eschatology got raised very productively. It has to do with the way in which Christianity effectively destroyed all of its competing sign systems by the 16th century, expelling peoples, committing genocide, burning books and temples en masse, and redrawing universal maps of location, history, and value in its own terms. So, for example, the people of Africa came to be viewed as the descendants of Ham, the disobedient son who deserved the fate of being made a servant to his brothers. And so all peoples who remained ignorant of the word of God became classified as heretics, and for that reason classified as barbarians, a word that President Obama used 2 days ago. The concept of barbarian emerges in Aristotle and Aquinas, who defines the other as those whose manner of life does not accord with human nature or common sense, what later came to be called natural law. If there is a human nature, then there is at least the possibility of an inhuman nature. And if we want to ward off this conclusion, if we want to make the concept of human nature truly universal and inclusive, we're going to have to engage with, we're going to have the tools to do a certain kind of reflexive analysis that the decontextualizing of philosophical thought has made all but impossible. This is the theological worldview that Mignolo refers to, devised in pagan Greece, retained in Christian traditions, and reformulated in secular terms by Hegel, among others. With God or without God, there's a theology to the extent there's a state of grace or a state of nature, a fall into authoritative scholasticism or submission to tyranny, a developmental trajectory of salvific enlightenment or scientific progress alongside industrialization, and a period of divine or transcendental punishment and judgment. And that's the task, of course, of philosophers. There are those who can cohabit the Garden of Eden or the Garden of Ethical Life, and those who must be shunted out. Inside the garden walls, there is a set of political protocols for the protection of rights and altogether different treatment for those outside the walls. Mignolo's point is that secularism simply adopted and adapted a prior Christian theological mapping with all its trappings of universal judgment. Christianity organized the peoples of the world fundamentally into those who see the light and are saved, and those who are unwilling and incapable of salvation. Modern secularism simply continues this schema. The categories now are racialized and associated with landmass or population genealogies. There's a wonderful geographical doublespeak in our profession, where the salience of the location of philosophical ideas is both avowed and denied. On the one hand, it's bad form to locate a philosophical idea. That's intellectual history. That's reductive analysis. That's beside the point. Ideas are ideas. On the other hand, colonial historiographies organize the ancient, meaning 4th century Greece, early modern, meaning 17th century Northwestern Europe, excluding Spain and Portugal, modern, meaning the same area in the 18th century, and 19th and 20th century philosophy, which includes here England, Scotland, the US, Canada, Germany, Austria, and France. These time maps represent modernist frames about the progression of reason, right? How reason progressed spatially and developmentally. If anything, the last few decades have witnessed a further narrowing of the field from when I was in graduate school, when Chinese and Indian philosophy were, you know, generally always included, and now they have been cut out. The history of philosophy, as we know, is today on the ropes and analytic compartments. One may think this solves the problem of the colonial narrative, but in reality, I think it only further ensures a decontextualization of thought. Philosophy is geographically located and is bounded in the West. It's a practice only possible at the end state of salvific developmental progression. And we can rest assured that those behind us, even if they start on the path we have charted, will never catch up. So the point here is that there is an implicit developmentalism in philosophy, in philosophy's idea of itself as the meta-discourse of the species. And this developmentalism tracks colonialism. The second idea Mignolo raises in that passage is the idea of ego politics. And this is a reference to Descartes, and in particular to Enrique Dussel's analysis of the role Descartes played in the formation of Western philosophy's colonial narrative about its own emergence, right? In the modern period, philosophy emerges as an uncaused cause, as an unmoved mover, miraculously. The philosophical scholarship of Descartes recently has taken some very productive turns of late. Descartes scholars are studying Arabic as they should. They're making connections with late medievalism, putting Descartes in relation to earlier periods and developing multi-layered readings of the nightmarish meditations. But what remains neglected is the link between Descartes and the Jesuitical tradition in which Descartes was educated. Within the Jesuit tradition, students were counseled to form as individuals. They had a different view about how you see the light. They didn't think it was the memorization of catechism. They thought you had to do an inventory of your own beliefs. You had to do a kind of self-examination under conditions of relative freedom in order to go through a process, and that way your dogmatic commitments would be real. This tradition was barely formed when Descartes began his studies. The Jesuit order was founded only in 1536. It came to the New World a short 13 years later in 1549, and so the development of Jesuit practice and thought was indelibly linked to the profound experiences of missionary work as well as the work of management and institution building that the Jesuits oversaw throughout the Americas. Descartes' association with the Jesuits, he was trained in Jesuit schools, he was educated in Jesuit schools. This links him securely to Spain, whose philosophy in this period is all but ignored, but also to the New World. The flow of intellectual influences across the Atlantic was intense in this period, and so it was not at all odd that Descartes studied logic from a work written by the well-known Mexican philosopher of that period, Antonio Rubio. How many of you can do that? The Jesuit belief in a thorough and sustained examination of conscious maps easily onto the Meditations on First Philosophy, first published in 1641, in which Descartes provides an uncanny reportage of his innermost doubts and debates. This self-examination is also clearly evident in Passions of the Soul, published in 1646. Dussel and other philosophers and historians have traced Descartes' formative influences also back to Fonseca, the Portuguese philosopher who influenced a generation of Jesuits known as the Coimbrian School, whose principal topic of discussion was the concept of method, identified as, quote, the art of reasoning about whatever probable question, unquote. Another Portuguese influence on Descartes that Dussel tracks is Francisco Sanchez, who proposed means to arrive at certainty through a process of doubt. Now, in as it's often made out to be, nor is it modern. Dussel suggests that we locate the emergence of modern thought with Bartolomeo Las Casas rather than Descartes. That is, with the emergence of a critical reflection on difference and material conditions rather than a conquering and isolated ego. As Mignola suggests, this is not to place perspectives alongside one another, but to shift registers. Where Descartes' aim is absolute or indubitable certainty, and where Descartes finds the root of perceptual sensation of material surroundings too defeasible for this purpose, it's not, you're not going to achieve certainty through perceptual evidence. Las Casas works through direct perception of material surroundings, the real world conditions of the Indians and their cultural achievements, and he uses that to test the dogmatism of church interpreters and their use of syllogistic reasoning. He recognizes the perspectivism of his location, and this is really important for Dussel. Las Casas recognizes the perspectivism necessary to produce judgments about what is strange and even what is barbarous. And Las Casas is engaging in substantive social critique of his dogmatic conventions. So what theo and ego politics have in common is an imperial design on time and space, where theo politics proposes a singular historical developmental trajectory of progress and redemption. Ego politics proposes a spatial mastery from a singular nodal point. It could be your own living room. Descartes' procedure requires no dialogic interlocutors, no collective process, and yet he thinks he can achieve a truth for all without speaking to all. It's a truth that speaks for all. Against this idea, Mignola proposes, quote, a geopolitics and a body politics of knowledge, knowledge produced from the geohistorical and biohistorical perspective of racialized locations and people, unquote. And I think what he means by this is not a reversal. It's not about replacing one perspective with another, but it's about a localization and a decentralization of knowledges and frames. In place of a singular trajectory of successive events in which every culture can be located as either ahead or behind, what he and others are proposing is a pluriversality of heterogeneous historical structural nodes. Las Casas moves us closer to this ideal by deflating the concepts that would legitimate hermeneutic closure or turning away from dialogue. Such a proposal causes problems and poses questions, no doubt, first and foremost, for white identity. I'm arguing in a forthcoming book, hopefully out by the end of this year, that whiteness is an identity among others. I'm uniting with Professor Outlaw on the question of the realness of identity to a certain extent. To a certain extent. We've worked together on this. I think whiteness needs to be understood not simply on the representational level or the discursive level, but also in terms of a set of historical events and macro events of history that produce subject formation in a certain way, which is true of all racialized groups. It's not distinct in that way. So I think whiteness is organic, and I think its history is indeterminate. It's a racial formation and process. I don't think we can say inevitably that whiteness will be tied to white supremacy forever, nor can we say it's inevitably going to move away from white supremacy. Might get worse, might get better. We can't, you know, that's just not, certainly not for us philosophers to predict, but I don't think anybody. But whiteness is also a formation of subjectivity with its own biohistorical perspective, though it's an identity among other social identities, no less or more internally complex and variegated within. It's certainly mediated and intersectional like all others. It's certainly of recent historical origin with uncertain provenance. And so I think it's less than either the white supremacists or some of the anti-racist whiteness studies people think. There is one element of exceptionalism to white identity, which is its dispersive position as standard bearer for the cutting edge developments of the human race. To be white is to be in the vanguard party of the species. Whites are the scientific, technological, moral, artistic, and political vanguard of the human race. We continue to hear the reverberations of this project every time a president, any president, announces the exceptional American capacity and right to lead the world in the expansion of democracy, freedom, and economic prosperity. The psychic benefit to white designated people of this characterization as the global vanguard continues to pay dividends even when the actual economic benefits are increasingly negligible for the majority of whites. And Du Bois was talking about this as early as 1935 in Black Reconstruction in America, but it is even more clearly so today. So although all racialized identities are social and historical constructs, the construction of whiteness has taken a specific form that poses unique and daunting challenges for an adaptation to the coming minority citizenship that will beset whites by 2042, and already besets whites in many major cities across the United States, and even four states. This is a serious obstacle to learning to live alongside others in relations of equality, to take your place in line, right? This is vanguard ideology discourse. We've begun to put philosophy's demographic problems, some of us, have begun to put philosophy's demographic problems within this overall sociological reality. Stop our own exceptionalism about philosophy. And I think the exceptionalism about philosophy is the idea that philosophy is transcendent or can be transcendent of its sociological and political context. White dominance in philosophy, both historically, globally, and in today's Western universities, helps provide the alibi for white vanguardist claims. That's my thesis here, is that white dominance in philosophy helps to provide the alibi, unalibi, and an important alibi. And I know, you know, you might argue against this by saying philosophy has no importance in the world. It doesn't trickle down. It doesn't reach outside these small rooms, but I think it plays a role in the sign system of Western white vanguardism that shouldn't be underestimated. The calm acceptance with which many react to white dominance in philosophy, where we try to talk about the need for our departments to be more diverse, and people, you know, look at us like we have two heads. That calm acceptance follows from this assumption. Of course, philosophy classrooms and the rosters of philosophy majors will remain mainly white male. It's the most difficult major. We argue a lot. It's very technical. It's the most intellectually demanding and creative, the one that presumes to know the most and to hew most closely to the line of truth. So what's the hidden premise here? Claim about identity. White racism takes the form of assumptions of enlightenment. It takes the form of entitlements. It thinks it's entitled to enlightenment, the claims of America. But it's useful, I think, to take the sort of list of entitlements that the social scientists have given us about, you can talk about male entitlement, but also white entitlement, and sort of apply these to philosophy. Entitlements involve entitlement to rights and resources, comfort and attention, access to space, deference, being granted presumptive credibility until proven otherwise. Now, entitlement is always complicated by class, gender, religion, and sexuality. Poor whites learn from an early age to defer to others. But white people as a whole, or as an imagined grouping, are the presumed paradigms of rights-bearing So it's inevitable that these social realities will find some manifestation in white majority or even exclusively white philosophy classrooms. This is especially so given the fact that philosophy curricular requirements almost never require courses. Now, sometimes there's courses on the curriculum, but they're not part of the required courses. They're not part of the sequence that you have to take for your distributions that might enhance students' knowledge or capacity to become more self-reflective about entitlement problems. So it should be no surprise that the work, the teaching, and scholarship produced by a white majority philosophy profession manifests in general an assumed entitlement to rights and resources, comfort and attention, access to space and deference. They assume the ability to access all knowledge and resist and resent theories that might restrict that access by talking about standpoint epistemology or the substantive dogmatic perspective of racial groups. They resent the idea that what one can understand on some matters may be affected by identity and experience. They assume the right to dominate the space, literal and figurative, of philosophical thought and discussion. They assume the right to have attention, and they assume this right is non-reciprocal, right? So others should be reading their work even while they neglect to read the work of non-whites. You can even take the concept of gentrification and apply it here, I think. It's just when white males claim to invent the subfield of social epistemology, which I'm still ticked off. It's like 20 years later, and I'm still ticked off. So feminists started doing work in feminist epistemology in the 70s, and feminist epistemology was all about power, knowledge, and social conditions and knowledge. And then there emerged, as if an unmoved mover from the head of Alvin Goldman and others, and Steve Fuller and others, who began to write texts. And these were texts on social epistemology. So they were ostensibly compilations of the, you know, central way to frame the questions, what the central questions were, without any attributions of the work that had gone before and was continuing to go on in feminist epistemology. So it's kind of like a gentrification, which people come in and buy up property, swagger about on the sidewalks, and ignore the local businesses. And, you know, when I say these things, of course I'm speaking in gross generalities. There are numerous individuals, white individuals, male individuals, that go against these generalizations, but this is a familiar pattern, I think. There's a culpable agency behind the maintenance in 2015 of a white philosophy profession. I think there's an agential aspect to it, a culpably agential aspect to it, and that one that we might think of as more structural. There is an agential aspect manifest in admissions committees, journal editors, teachers, and professional associations, such as, most importantly, the American Philosophical Association. There's also a discursive and political effect, I think, that is more diffuse than a particular, that can be traced to a particular individual, but there's a kind of more diffuse discursive effect in shoring up the idea of white vanguardism. That is, that it is naturally the case that the leading intellectual fields, whether in technology or the philosophy or the neurosciences, will be white, right? It is the calm acceptance of that. It is the acquiescence to that. It is perhaps a sense that that's natural for now. Others may catch up, but they will always be behind, right? So my claim here is that our profession is feeding the beast of white vanguardism and white supremacy, and it needs to stop.
Important, and I think Linda makes a good point, is when we come to these spaces, you probably recognize at every moment how unusual it is, but it really is. And so I'm very glad to be here to be able to sort of do this. What I'm going to do today is sort of in two, perhaps three different parts. I want to talk a little bit about my contribution to the volume, but only a little bit, just to whet your appetite so you'll go out and get your own. But we can talk more about that later on. So some of the Nietzsche stuff is going to sort of get thrown over here, and we can certainly come back to it if people want to, and I'll kind of raise my hand and sort of jiggle my fingers when there's some Nietzsche stuff that comes up that we can pretend it's a hyperlink and we can come back and click on it later on. But then what I also want to do is, well, what might come from what I talk about in my essay? And part of what I talk about is, how do we talk about healthy racialized identity if we assume racism is permanent, right? So following Derek Bell, assume racism is permanent, which everyone's like, we can't do that. I'm like, okay, why don't we do it? Right? In philosophy, we do thought experiments all the time. We do minds in vats. I mean, given the evidence out there, assuming racism is permanent, it's not that crazy, right? So assuming that, then how can, particularly for black people, people of color, can we talk about healthy racialized identity, right? And I should say healthier, right? I don't want to get into that there is healthy and then everything is not, but healthier racialized identities, right? So that's what that is about. And then I want to sort of make a segue to then saying, well, can we also then talk about a way of having healthier racialized identities for those people who are not people of color, right? For those people who have sort of benefited very much from the privileges that can go along with white supremacy. So those are sort of the two sort of places. But I want to put this under a different rubric, which is something that we started talking about last night and then we've talked about today, which is the role of theory. Now, I get paid to talk about theory, I get paid to teach it, I get paid to write about it, I get paid to evaluate other people for how they do in terms of theory. So, you know, right now, that's my baggage. I'm not going to throw theory out, right? It's my bread and butter. It's also what I love. So I'm really sad that Paul isn't here in some sense, because there's ways in which we undercut that part, right? The ways in which philosophy can actually speak to us as human beings. The way that philosophy and theory can make our lives meaningful, right? We're not supposed to talk about them. We're supposed to talk about how it leads to truth and blah, 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 blah. But you feel good, you like it, right? And not like it because it's easy, but because it's challenging, because you've grown from it. And so I don't want to throw theory out. And I was with Sally at this point of like, oh my gosh, well, what do we do? We can't seem to find a theory that will sort of get rid of this altogether. And then, you know, Lucius are sort of argued, well, look, the civil rights movement, they weren't waiting for theory. Right? And I said, yeah, in some sense that's true. And then I thought, but wait a minute, not really. Right? There were theories that were part of it, but it wasn't just theory. They weren't sitting in a room saying, okay, let me tell you about this nonviolence, this is the way to do it. Right? There's a way in which they took some theory, you could argue, some Gandhian notions of nonviolence, something from the Highlander Folk Center, something from the citizenship schools, and I could go on and on and on and on, right? And took those theories and made them their own, and deployed them in a particular situation. And I'm just throwing out a couple institutions, Black Church, sort of the separatist Black institutions that were created because of white supremacy, right? And through that, in a crucible, right, forged something else that wasn't just theory and wasn't just practice, but something that was amazing. And I think, in some sense, I think that's what you were sort of getting at. But it wasn't just theory. It wasn't just, not that there's anything wrong with it, something that's just published in a journal, right? And so I'm like, well, how then can we do something like that? And part of what I really appreciate about what Derek Bell wrote about was it seems like there's something about what he calls the sort of the civil rights vision, right, that has worked at a certain point. It has brought about incredible change, but in some ways it hasn't, right? And you don't have to walk too far, turn on the news, talk to people to realize there's certain things that have not changed at all or very little, right? So it's very easy, I think, for people, particularly my generation, those younger than me, to just feel despair. Like, well, what are we supposed to do now? That whole civil rights thing, we tried doing it, it got us so far, but we seem sort of stuck. So So we keep trying to do more, but that's not really working. So how do we deal with this hopelessness, right? And so for me, this is where Nietzsche started talking to me. Because Nietzsche, in some sense, sort of starts from a place, what he called decadence, a place of hopelessness, a place of nihilism. And as opposed to then saying, we're just going to drown in it, we're just going to give up, right? There's a way in which you can revalue that. So he talks about strong versus weak pessimism. So that's just the background for talking about this. So part of what I do in my essay is to find ways to disrupt the comfort of those who are secure in the system of advantages and disadvantages, right, that come in our lovely system of white privilege that exists in our country, right? And in some sense, decenter whiteness as a way of envisioning and enacting race. And so move away, have the courage, right, to move away from assuming that rational argument's going to push people to forgo advantages. With some people, it has. Well, a lot of people, it hasn't really, right? They'll go, oh, yeah, that's right, and then just sort of continue their life. So assume racism is permanent, right? Part of what Bell says is, well, then, what's the approach to that? How do you have a healthier sort of way, right? So he says, well, contestation against racism, right, a communal struggle, right, to affirm, right, the lives of those people who are contesting is an identity in itself. It can help to, using machine language, it can lead to life affirmation, right? And it's not just about individuals doing, in part, it's a sort of a communal, right? And so part of what Nietzsche says, and this is what, and so I read this in Derek Bell, and the first time I read Derek Bell, and I used to teach Derek Bell, I'd be like, well, this is sort of depressing, but it's sort of a nice way, and then we can move on to other things, right? Because I was very like, oh, theory will change things. Well, you know, I'm not so sure that that alone is going to do it, right? Rational argument alone isn't going to do it. But then I said, well, what does that look like, Derek Bell? What does that look like, right? We've seen some of this in the civil rights movement. What does that look for us now? And so this is what made me think of Nietzsche. Nietzsche uses the term versuchen, right, which can mean to experiment, to attempt, but also to sort of tempt people, right? And so Nietzsche talks about the need to experiment with embodying a type of pessimism, right? Not the weak pessimism, there's no truth, there's never going to be any truth, any truth that you create is going to decay, and then you die, right? That's what he calls weak pessimism. That's the pessimism that he sees underlying most of traditional philosophy, right? He talks about how do you then embody a pessimism of strength, as he calls it, a predilection for the gruesome, evil, problematic aspects of existence, right? And how do you do that out of overflowing health as opposed to mere avoidance, right? And so when I read Derek Bell, and he quoted, I'm gonna get the quote wrong, from this woman in Mississippi, and he said, like, how do you continue doing this? And she said something like, sorry, I got the quote wrong, but it's quoted correctly in here. She said something like, I lives to harass white folks, right? And for her, it wasn't just like, I just love beating people down. She's like, by engaging in this harassment, I'm fighting back. I'm creating my own space. I'm creating myself, right? And I was like, oh, that reminds me of Nietzsche. That's exactly it. And so I thought, well, how do we bring that notion to life? And so for me, this goal of a strong pessimism in terms of race, right, is a way of moving just beyond the hopelessness, oh, there's no point to it all, right? But that doesn't mean that we try to then aim for sort of colorblindness, where we get rid of race altogether. And George Yancey calls it the effortless race of colorblindness. So we get to the point where sort of, this is quoting Yancey, right, we get to the effortless race of engaging that world with a deep sense of freedom, connectedness, and reciprocity, right? He contends that sort of many people, white people, people who are privileged in the society, move through a world as though their desires, instincts, and values are the norm. And I read this and I go, wow, what is that like? I mean, I have no idea. I have small moments in my life where for a second I might feel that sort of this effortless grace. But I am forever aware of who I am, where I am, how people are perceiving me, how I might be affecting other people, et cetera. And part of it is a hyper-awareness that I've learned. It's also a question for my safety, right? And so you know what? What we're supposedly aiming for is that everyone should get this effortless grace, right? So it's not just white people, but it's all people of color. Let's all aim for effortless grace. We move through the world with a deep sense of freedom, connectedness, reciprocity, others. And it seems to me that's going to be a win-lose proposition. So let's get people to move away from effortless race as the goal. Get them to see that racism, in some sense, is a congenital handicap. We are in this society. If racism is permanent, it's congenital. There is no ready escape from it. And then push people towards experimentation, to engendering new strengths. Right? And again, people are like, oh, that sounds really kumbaya. Like, that really happens. Go to communities of people of color. This is what you will see. Right? Not with everyone, but communities that are vibrant, that are living, this is some of what you will see. And so in my essay, I pulled from The Miners' Canary by Lonnie Grenier and Gerald Torres, who are law professors, who I think very much are pulling from the spirit of Bell, about what are these notions of race that can come from that, and what might that lead to. And part of what this leads to for me is, as Nietzsche says, in order to feel differently about race, you first have to think differently about race. And this seems to me where theory can come into play. Not with everyone, right? But I think for a lot of people, that can be the way to do it. It's a way then to get to not just thinking, but get at our bodily habits, right? And in order to do that, I'm sorry, comfort out the door. Discomfort's the way to go. So let's all embrace discomfort. Yay! Right? And again, this sounds crazy, right? But again, for people of color, that's how we live. Right? And for some people, they manage to thrive with that. Now, I would love a little less discomfort. I'd love to share it with other people. And then perhaps that's what we should do. Right? So for Nietzsche, pain and suffering can be something productive. Right? Because part of what comes from that is a self-knowledge. Right? He says what it comes from is, he uses the term fertifum, right? A profundity. Right? The self-reflection, a profundity that comes from that, and also possibly a self-mastery. And for Nietzsche, self-mastery isn't, I'm the master of my domain, I can do whatever I want. It's understanding all those hints, instincts, desires that are within you, understanding kind of how they work, and perhaps working to deploy them or push them in particular ways, but knowing that is always changing. So, that's just, now you've gotten to read it, right? Okay. So I basically gave a version of this talk at LaGuardia Community College. I think it was last year at some point. And it was an amazing talk, I mean, not amazing talk, but it was an amazing space where it was mainly philosophy majors and minors at this community college, many of them people of color, many of them first generation, many of them had immigrated to the United States themselves or whose parents had. Right? And their philosophy majors or minors, and given what Linda's talked about, that's a miracle, right? Because they're doing it because they think it somehow speaks to them. What? Right? You want to talk about discomfort, right? And not only that, it's a Saturday afternoon. Many of them had taken time off work to come hear a symposium with undergraduates speaking, and then I gave the talk at the end, right? Amazing space. So before I talked, a white professor in the department came and spoke to me, specialized in philosophy of mind and cognitive science, and he was talking, because I don't know much about Nietzsche, I'm not sure how I feel about this, and what's this talk about nihilism, you know? And, you know, I've heard Nietzsche, I've heard he's okay, but you could tell he was kind of lifting the eyebrow, like, I don't think hardly of it, right? But he was interested to learn. Did not buy that for a second, but it was fine. And then he started talking about his Native American heritage, which I was like, I'm not sure what that had to do with anything.
People of color together.
Oh, so I missed the bonding moment. So after the talk, right, directed towards people of color, how to deal with racism, permanent, how do you deal with this, right? What's the possibility of having a healthier racial identity, right? And he was one of the first questions. He made sure of it, right? And he asked me how my talk might speak or persuade someone like him, right, who is well-meaning and progressive. And he said, my talk lacked anything to help him. And this is not a standalone thing. You can read, like, for instance, I just read George Yancey's essay, and I'm like, oh my God, yes, I had the same thing, right? And so he said, what do I have to help him? He said, you have nothing for me in this talk, right? And I just wanted to say, yes, that's right. And then go, next question, right? And I kind of did. I mean, I talked about it a little bit more, right? And I said, this talk isn't sort of for people, for him or for people like him, right? invited, hey, you might actually learn something, right? So part of my comments today, and I'm going to finish up soon, is to try to sort of pivot, and this is just the beginnings of something, so I'd love to talk more about this, and sort of talk about the possibility of racism being permanent, and then what happens then to white identity, right? If we're going to talk about experimentation, if we're going to talk about Firsuchin, what happens? And part of what I want to say is for those people who feel they're in that category, you guys go off and figure that out, right? But I do think that part of what I'm saying here can address this. So that's sort of what I want to say. And so part of it is the danger, and you all have dealt with this, and perhaps some of you have felt this, right? Is that when they sort of, when you finally allow themselves to feel sort of racism, right, and the fact that they're on the side of those who are privileged, right, what the internal dialogue is like, God, this racism sucks. And you're like, yeah, it does. And they go, because, you know, I'm accused of it, and I'm made to feel guilty and made to feel shame, even though I didn't do anything, or I didn't really intend to do anything, right? And so then they just get stuck in that space, right? And so then what happens? Right? So then what happens is often is any time that type of person is in an environment where they feel discomfort because of race, they want to move away from it. Right? It's almost like an amoeba, right? So remember, was it biology in high school? You sort of touch it with a pencil, part of it moves away, right? So it's just like you just go la 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 la, like I don't want to deal with it, right? Or, right? Or you just want to remove that stimulus. So an amoeba can't move away the stimulus, but human beings have a few more cells, et cetera. We can do that. So there's a way in which, theoretically, we remove the stimulus. Oh, well, you're talking about race, but this is really just about all people. Or yes, you're talking about race, and that's interesting, but constant so much other stuff, right? Or, you know, and there's a way of just like trying to move it. And that happens at the theoretical level, and it's aggressive, and it's violent to some degree. But there's also a way that happens at the practical level, and it's aggressive, and it's violent, and people die. So there's a way in which sort of that fear, right, that ignorance, they don't know what to do, is really, really a problem. And perhaps trying to address that, right, at a practical level is a way out of it. So part of it is, if I'm going to speak to my white professor who wants me to speak to him and tell him, like, what do I have for him, is, accept racial discomfort. It's awesome, right? And George Yancey sort of pulls from the Heideggerian notion of tarrying, right? So maybe as opposed to just like, oh, I feel really awful, stop. Stop. Stop trying to react to it. Stop trying to explain it away. Stop trying to have someone solve it for you. Sit with that feeling. I have to do it all the time, right? And then see what comes from that. Battle with it. Sit with it, right? This is how self-knowledge and perhaps self-mastery can come out. Now, this is going to be a hard sell, but quite frankly, a lot of people take on discomfort all the time in their lives, right? So it used to be once a year I would train to do marathons, having some issues with plantar fasciitis, not sure if it will ever happen again. But I see a lot of people out there now training for marathons, right? And exercising all the time, right? And what do you do for marathon training? I'm going to go out and do 18 miles. I'm going to get up at 4 o'clock in the morning. And I'm going to pay for a group to help me train. Right? People take discomfort on all the time because they see it as discomfort as a place of growth. So theoretically, this is not a crazy notion. And offers in going, starting at one point, going 26.2 miles, and ending almost at the same point, and getting a medal and some free Gatorade at the end. There's something to it, but perhaps learning something about yourself, learning how to deal with other people, and perhaps actually changing the way in which we engage this, and perhaps stop people from killing other people, I'm thinking that's a type of discomfort more people should sort of buy into, right? But it requires courage, right? So I want to say that this approach, right, we tend to gauge it as sort of an epistemological project, etc., but it's also an ethical and existential project. And this is part of where Paul's essay sort of came in, right? So the initial goal isn't to solve racism. It might end up doing that. I don't know. I don't even know what it means to solve racism, right? I have no idea. I don't know what it is to get beyond sort of our current racial construct. I have no idea. I can't even imagine that, right? But I know that there's a way in which right? We can come to understand the way we feel that we embody our racialized habits that really might change things, right? We are all multiple selves. Some parts are better, some parts are worse, right? And we can learn to feel those worse selves. Most of the time we don't want to, we just pretend they don't exist. We can learn to understand them, how they work, and we can garner a type of Nietzschean mastery of them through experiment, through versuchen, right? And perhaps learn to deploy them more willfully, more thoughtfully, or how to mitigate against them, right? Or know when they tend to come out, right? Anyone who's had any type of congenital issue knows that this is the case. It's your worthy opponent, right? I'm dyslexic. I would love not to have to deal with my dyslexia. There is no chance of that, right? So I have to learn to somehow embrace the funky way that my brain works and try to deal in a world that doesn't recognize that funky way, right? But there's all sorts of stuff that can come out of that. But merely trying to fight it and end it doesn't work, right? So maybe some of these metaphors might be a way to approaching a theory which could then change things.
Changes functionally that isn't already accounted for in the permanence of racism thesis, right? So saying that maybe small changes happen, but ultimately nothing really happens, you can undergird that with like racial fortuity, right, interest convergence. So I'm wondering, is there a tension? Am I misreading something in what you're, am I reading too much into what you're saying about what whites need to do or the efficacy of them doing it? What do you see as the outcome of whites sitting with their discomfort, learning to be with others, that isn't contraindicated by the permanence of racism thesis?
And I think there is a tension there, right? And part of it is I'm not a scholar of Bell. I have not read everything that Bell has written. I would love to, and that's something I plan on doing, right? Well, not everything, God, he wrote a lot, but anyway.
I was about to say,
before I say that, I'm not gonna
He's a great writer.
He's a great writer, no, a lot of it's a pleasure to read, right? But I think that part of it is, and I'm sort of playing a little bit fast and loose here, so this is not sort of, is to say that there is a tension here, right? And so if we assume that racism is impermanent, right? Like I said, I had sort of, you know, my white colleague who's just like, oh, but what about me? What do you have for me? And I'm like, well, you go figure out what you're going to do. But quite frankly, what you're doing is you're running away from the discomfort, and that's really not helping you. It's not helping me or anyone else, right? So sit with that, right? And I think part of what that sort of begins to do is to sort of recognize the ways in which the outside world constitutes us, right? So part of sitting with that is I feel bad now about this guy, this white colleague, right? I think there was a way in which he was just like, don't feel bad about that. He just did not want to deal. It didn't have to do, you know, you either tell him what to do or so we can solve it or something, but he wasn't going to do that work himself. So part of it is like, do this work. Because part of why, yes, we are in some sense constituted by the world around us, but there's a way in which we engage in that and constitute ourselves. There has to be a back and forth. And in some sense, he's pretending like that is not the case, right? And in another sense, when that world does sort of get in, he's willing to admit, he's like, oh, that's uncomfortable. I don't like that. So for me, that's where that sort of begins, right? It begins as a type of self-reflection. I don't think that ends necessarily racism, right? But that's not, I think, the goal at this point, because I don't understand what that is as a goal. But it's first understanding the world in which we live and feeling the ramifications of that world in which we live. And I think there are many people who are at the top of this hierarchy who don't have to feel it. It's the effortless grace, right? And so I think that's part of what I want to get at.
Can I say something on that? Because it's a good question. I mean, I don't like Bell's, you know, formulation of the permanence of racism, because it seems so outside of history to me. I prefer the one about the permanence of the danger, you know, the persistence of the danger from Foucault, that it's all, everything is dangerous, Foucault says, which is different from saying everything will sort of stay the same in this bad state. What he's saying is that we may have a moment of progress, but it cannot be relied upon to stay in that state. So you have to constantly stay reflective and vigilant. But I think the permanence of racism, certainly as you use it, Jackie, is a good antidote to the developmentalism.
Yeah.
I think that's what Bell's after, which is good. And that's also what Foucault's after, is an antidote to the assumption that we're going to get smarter and more moral, and we don't have to do a whole lot for that to happen, because it's kind of this inevitable trajectory. It's the Christian, you know, salvific stuff.
I think you had your hand up next, right?
So I have a two-part question. Jackie, on the one hand, you know, so what happens when, so we accept the race as permanent thesis, we use racial realism, which is looking at economics and facts.
Could you speak up a little bit?
Sure. So what happens if we accept the race as permanent thesis, and we say, okay, well, let's work as the basis of theorization there. So I've kind of done that. That's the work I do. But then what happens when we get people like, you know, Cobb, you know, all this nonviolent stuff will get you killed, or we will shoot back, or we start reading people like Robert F. Williams. So if we create theories based on the premise of racism, then certainly that gives us political theories that many people consider to be ideological, where you have someone like Robert F. Williams saying, look, you know, white people are dangerous, white women are dangerous, we should defend ourselves with guns, we should kill them. Or you have someone like the Black Panther Party that does that. So how does, what's the normative limit of accepting racism as permanent? Is it just for the discomfort, or is it that we're producing theories that very much question the structure, the lives of the people that sustain it? And the second part of the question, for Linda, so when you were talking about a colonial historiography, I mean, I find that very interesting, but what happens when the categories that we hold dear, things like feminism or womanhood, become implicated? So we look at colonial spaces like Cuba or Africa or even the southern United States, we have, and it's not to sound provocative, but we have real histories of white men that eat black men, that boil their bodies down to elixirs, where white women raped black men, where white Klan women cut off the balls of black men and make them eat their penises. Like, this is the history of what it looks like. So how do we give the substance of those categories within this historiography that can give some kind of meaning to this history and do that in philosophy? Because if we do that, then that means that all the cherished movements, the kinds of epistemologies that you're talking about that made some groundway, are in fact very implicated in terms of how it's killed people and raped people and murdered people, cut babies out of women's stomachs, and it rewrites the way that we view sexual violence, where it's not simply male and female, but a homoeroticism of slavery, where white men raped black men, that these things become, this changes our sacred notions of queer equality. So how do we do all that, given that we have people that don't even want to talk about racism? Are they going to give up these privileged positions, these vulnerabilities that give them special insights to oppression?
I mean, my answer is going to be really, really short, which is, I don't know. And oops, you're not supposed to say that, right? Sorry. Right?
I wonder if you would accept it. Would you accept something like that based on accepting?
Look, if I were following Nietzsche down the line, I'd have to be like, well, in some sense, we have to be open to it. We're just not going to cut it out. But then Nietzsche would sort of create these sort of things. I'm not following Nietzsche down the line, right? I would like to find a way to draw some lines and distinctions there. But at the same time, I don't want to sort of merely be reactionary and sort of thoughtful. And so that's why we need, I guess, people like you as well as other people to start developing and try to figure out how we sort of, how we draw those lines and how we make those distinctions.
Well, I'd say that the decolonial project, you know, this group of people, Ramon Gross Fogel and other people that I work with and am involved with, women's rights convention that happened in the mid-1800s happened at the seat of the Iroquois Confederacy. It's not surprising at all, because they were influenced there was a whole bunch of crazy sort of nascent feminist evangelicals that were emerging in this part of the world. There was all these Bible communists. They were influenced by Native people. So we're retelling the history of ideas and influences. But beyond that, we also have to, I think, check our developmentalist tendencies of all sorts to think that there's one track for all. And there's a lot of new books about separate roads of feminism that are being talked about. So rather than thinking there's one track and one idea of what gender liberation would look like, we need to understand multiple tracks, and we need to stop thinking that it's going to get better and better and better. That's the really problematic historiography.
Yes,
all right, wait, I just want to spread the questions out evenly, so I'll just this side, and then we'll go back to this side, if that's okay. Just to be fair. Yeah, you can.
Okay, my question is for Professor Scott. So I really like the idea of strong pessimism. Sorry, I really like the idea of strong pessimism generally, but I think maybe there's a worry about it when you think about racism. Maybe if we assume that strong pessimism, then maybe we're gonna be willing to concede or countenance more suffering than we need to, right? Because if we're trying to like deal with discomfort and be okay with it in some sense. And I don't know if that makes sense.
Well, I mean, look, we already do. Right? I mean, there's certain things that, I don't know if people are back to me, but I mean, we already do this, right? We put up with more suffering than we have to. In a daily situation, you have to decide, like, do I deal with this now or not? Okay, fine, whatever, you know? And so we already do that, right? But we need to recognize that we're doing that, and we need to make decisions and deployments, and some people do and some people don't. And actually being able to make those decisions, in some sense, is a luxury, right? So I agree that there's a danger here, right? But we can't sort of be like, oh, we can't do this because there's no danger. Let's wait, we'll do the one where there's no danger. You'll be waiting a long time, right? So I think part of it is, and this is perhaps what's part of the theoretical work, but it's the theoretical work that can come out of practice, because this is what people do, to find out, like, how do you negotiate that, right? How do you decide, right? Is it communal, is it individual? Right? As a community, we decide, nope, this is it, Boston, no more, right? We've put up with this long enough, right? And I'm going to say, well, you know what, whatever. If they're going to think that that's fine, I'm going to go do my thing, right? But I think we need to do this more consciously and thoughtfully, right, than we have done. But there is a danger to this. Because as Nietzsche points out, right, and I don't have to just go to Nietzsche, but he's my dude and he sort of speaks to me, but we could sort of cite, I don't know how many other people who have said this, right, that you're going to, and clearly this is in some sense Foucault as well, like when you find sort of this positive way, right, that sort of speaks to you, it's going to decay. It's going to change. At some point it does sort of become dangerous, and sometimes it's dangerous in a good way, and then not. But there's a type of vigilance, right, that we need to have, that I think that a lot of people of color do have, right, often not spoken about sort of communally, right? And that needs to happen sort of more often.
Can I just say one thing? No.
It's okay. There's a lot of questions.
Sure.
If there's time. Second row right here, and then behind it.
My question is for Linda. Thank you so much for talking. Kind of follows up on Tommy's point a bit. So our discipline's feeding the beast, right? And so I think we're on the point there, and you started by saying, right, but the solution can't be, you know, add and stir, right? Which also seems to be clear. But I'm concerned a little bit then about what we do, and obviously, like, my frame of reference is something like Latin American philosophy, right, where Eurocentric perspectives have shaped, right, and have had some kind of influence on the formation of the tradition, not just how it considers itself philosophical or not, but even just on the general, you know, categories that tend to get used, right? So I'm even thinking of Las Casas, right, as the example, right, that although he does provide us some kind of perspectivism vis-a-vis Descartes or something like that, he still has a very he uses a language of pacifism to talk about Native Americans, right? So we end up with this kind of tension that drops out of that. of that, right, if the solution isn't just add and stir. Does that make sense? Yeah. So if you can speak a little bit to that.
There's so much work to do. There's so much work to do. I mean, there's so many texts that have not been translated. There are texts written by native peoples in the 1500s around the time that were kept in the Vatican for 300, 400 years and are only now seeing the light of day, getting translated. So the textual tradition isn't even available and accessible widely yet. Once we get, you know, more of that textual tradition, then there is, think of how many thousands of pages have been spent trying to interpret Kant and make sense of Kant. There's a lot of work to do. I mean, there's an interpenetration of these discourses that I think is important to as a starting base. So that's part of why it's not about adding perspectives onto each other, because they are making others possible or not. They are shifting registers. They are conflicting frames in some cases, but they are influenced by one another. So it's not like there's a pure, unmediated tradition that we can go to for alternative iconographies and sign systems. But what that also means is that what we call the Western tradition, as everybody has said from Sayyidan, is not simply Western. We need to re-understand, like feminism, we need to re-understand what it means and what the history of feminism is and what the Enlightenment is and what Western philosophy is. So that there's so much work that needs to happen to do all this. You have to stay in the profession. Get tenure.
I guess this question is for you, Babcock, or
Scott.
Sorry. I mean, the question is it's essentially like a "what does this do for me" type of question. In terms of the idea of the thrust of philosophy is kind of like political. It's a political theory, political will. I guess maybe the question is, do you see a paradigm for that embodying of the pessimism, that constant focus on embracing that discomfort, that could have a political expediency? Because in playing fast and loose with a conception of philosophy, is this idea that it could advance notions of feminism or animal rights or things of that nature that we wouldn't have considered before. So do you see that constant embracing of the discomfort could have that same sort of political agency? I think that makes sense.
It does make sense. And this is another case where I have to go I don't really know. In some sense, because part of what I'm interested in is starting very locally. What does it mean for an individual to have a healthier racialized identity, right? Sorry. But then we get to the level of groups, and then we get to the level of systems. I don't do so well, right? In part, that's sort of not my training. But there are plenty of people in this room who do this sort of thing. And so I don't know. But I wanted to start with first, what does it mean for an individual or for individuals to have a healthier sort of way of deploying race? And then how does that work on the next scale is work that needs to be done. And I just don't know if I'm the one to do it right now. So sorry to disappoint you if I do.
Yeah, so I have a question for Jackie, and also a question for Linda.
Make it long, Bob, so I can get my lavender up.
For Jackie, first of all, it seems to me that the number of whites who actually feel uncomfortable about race or about being racist are, but that may be actually a small number of people.
Yeah.
It may be an extraordinarily small number of people. So it looks to me like, you know, your audience is essentially, you know, maybe the classic, you know, paradigm, you know, guilty white liberal. Okay. So one question is that what your audience is? And if that's your audience, because I mean, in other words, your audience has to be, by hypothesis, is those who feel uncomfortable. But you know, I'm suggesting that's going to be a small number of our people. So if your audience is white liberal, then it kind of looks like you're basically functionalizing. This is something I've written about in my essays on film and so forth and so on. But like you're functionalizing blackness as a kind of supplemental whiteness. You basically, you're saying to the guilty white liberal, you're feeling guilty, but you need to be more like black people, because black people are kind of need the chance. You know, they know how to, you know, they have predilection for the gruesome. They've lived through the gruesome, they have predilection for the gruesome. If you're like black people, then you'd be good with being a good guilty like white liberal. So I worry about the kind of functionalization of blackness as a supplement. My question to Linda is just, well, I don't know. I mean, at one point you quoted someone who suggests, do people really care about philosophy or something? I mean, you know, is I guess I kind of, you know, hear myself saying that, and I guess I'd like to hear more. It just seemed like a very self-flattering kind of, you know, we're philosophers, we're the, you know, and we're feeding the beast, but, you know, there's so many other things that feed the beast, you know. And the things that feed the beast intellectual life, they don't just feed philosophy, they feed physics, they feed, you know, social, they feed all sorts of, you know, disciplinary formations. And philosophy feeding the beast, maybe it's like one, you know, I don't know if I'm trying to, I can't have a name of think of a good metaphor, but, you know, if the beast needs a hearty meal, right, and you say, well, what contribution is philosophy, is what we do, you know, when we go to the APA or write articles or publish articles, when it's all kind of dominated by whiteness and so forth and so on, what is our contribution to feeding the beast? Will the beast even miss it if, you know, the philosophy feed weren't there? I mean, maybe if the beast has a, you know, I don't know, went to McDonald's, you know, let's suppose we were feeding the beast the McDonald's meal. Maybe, you know, philosophy stops feeding the beast. Maybe, you know, we're just going to take one French fry away from your, you know, jumbo French fry, or one corn, you know, one bit of popcorn from your, you know, you go to the movies and say, would you like a, you know, sir, would you like a larger, you know? Yeah. So you see what I'm saying. I apologize for my lack of literary, you know, finesse.
You made me hungry for French fries. So,
I mean, Bob, I think you're right. And I haven't sort of developed this thought a huge amount because I wasn't terribly interested in it. And it just came up because this is what came up during the talk, right? And I've given sort of a version in a couple of other places, and a couple of people have brought this up, and I thought I should have. I felt like, you know what, I guess I could say something more beyond that. But you're right, it's a limited of scope. If someone who's already open to the possibility of, like, I'm not liking this, right? But if they're like, could they just feel like ignoring it, right? Or they're going to denounce it, I'm not sure what I have to say.
What do I want to say to the guilty white liberal? You know, read Nietzsche. You know, what? Learn. Why do I want to bother with that?
I don't think you have to. If you don't want to.
No, I don't. I thought that was. Sorry.
No. I mean, I guess I'm saying. But I'm just saying.
Yeah.
Look, sort of from the place where I was speaking,
right?
I felt like the guy's like, you have nothing for me. You didn't speak to me.
Right.
And there was a part of me that wanted to say, yes, well, I wasn't speaking to you.
Right.
But you know what? If I had been in your place, which is weird because, you know, I haven't lived in that body.
Right.
You know, I would think, I mean, I do this all the time, right? I read Hegel and I translate, how does this speak to me? And I have to do all sorts of translation. He was unwilling to do any translation. I didn't address him. So I guess for that small audience, and it's a small audience, but where I'm speaking now, hey, might be the same people, right? That this is something, you read Nietzsche because precisely Nietzsche does try to disrupt that, right? And besides getting from Nietzsche, whatever else people get out of it, that there's a way that Nietzsche might speak to this condition, and so it might be useful. But you're right, I'm not saying that we now should have a school curriculum sort of based on sort of Nietzsche and this notion of sort of racialized discomfort or something like that, because yeah, I think most people will not buy it. And so it's not going to sort of be much of a sell here.
Well, let me address 2 points that you made, Bob. I mean, about the small number of white liberals that may be concerned about their position vis-a-vis racism. Actually, I think the country is different today than it was when you and I were growing up. I was following the opinion polls by Pew and these different organizations pretty closely for this whiteness project I've been working on, and you still find a differential between whether or not the police, even in their own communities, can be trusted not to use excessive violence on, I mean, and majority of whites, you know, accept the need, you know, to allow interracial marriage and affirmative action, you know, is going up. So what we're often looking at is we're looking at the difference between the whites who accept these anti-racist views and people of color's views, and you still find differences. But what we're missing, I think, is to look just at the whites to see the split. So if you have 50% of whites who disagree on these accounts about racism, you've got another 50 or 47% sometimes who are agreeing largely with people of color in this country.
No, no, I'm not saying that all white people are racist. I'm just saying that white people are racist don't feel bad about it for the most part.
Well,
just go to the 50%.
What I'm interested in is, you know, what I'm interested in is not the white race, so not the bad 50%, but the other 50%. That's the one that I'm finding interesting. And I don't think there's going to be a natural progression, so that's going to get larger and larger until everybody sees the light. But that other large, you know, significant numbers of white people who are living in multiracial communities and going to multiracial schools and living in multiracial environments and answering to multiracial professional managerial, you know, bosses and so forth, are experiencing a different kind of world. And are those transformations in white subject formation that I think are, you know, are interesting. So that's the class that I think is interesting to look at. But the other question about the uselessness and irrelevance of our profession, Bob. I mean, on one level, yes, you know, I live with a guy who works in the labor movement, and he's constantly telling me how useless and irrelevant, you know, the theoretical norms are in the actual work of trying to defend and develop the labor movement and defend and develop workers' rights. But on the other hand, the founding of our nation and every nation is based on a set of ideas that philosophers have articulated, not invented. I don't think philosophers invent. We give articulation to, right, as Hegel said. And it is important. So the ideas today maybe aren't Rawls, but they are John Locke and they are John Stuart Mill's that are founding ideas in Supreme Court cases over and over again. So I think that, you know, in some ways we know we're discounted because we're ridiculed and made fun of as philosophy majors and philosophy teachers by our families, right? and we know that we can't get money out of deans for the philosophy department, right? So there's a material reality and a social reality to this disrespect to our profession. But I think that belies the important discursive role that philosophical ideas and articulations have played in narratives of progress, narratives of state legitimation, narratives of racial organization and colonialism. I think they actually do play a role. And when we have vastly white majority profession doing things about the brain that has just been given a gazillion dollars by the government to do research on the brain, and who's going to participate in this research from the humanities? It's not going to be us. It's going to be those guys doing the neurosciences, which is an all-white group. This is a problem. It's a problem. Because it's a problem both because I think it will it'll diminish the quality of the research, and also because it will help support the alibi of white dominance that whites are the natural leaders in the intellectual field of every dimension. So we're one dimension among others. But we are one dimension.
There was a question right here.
My question is for Professor Alcoff. I was wondering, in the way you were talking about the project of decolonialized historiography, where we start making the connections, for example, between the Enlightenment and Descartes' work that have never really been made before, and how that has to complexify the way we draw these boundaries. So I was wondering what you would then say about the cultural and historical production of difference once we start doing that, and you see that sort of developing.
Well, I want to take a more organic view, even though there are state discourses that produce borders and concepts and boundaries. Latino identity is an obvious example. It's not just white identity that has been created by the state. So there is a creation of difference. There's a marking of difference. There's a creation of institutions and practices that then throw people together so that they have similar experiences. And then, but I think it's a mistake. And again, I find Foucault useful. We each have our guides in philosophy, right? Still. Because of the insistence on the bottom-up as well as the top-down understanding of the ways in which meanings circulate and change. So, and that's why I also like Omi and Wynant's understanding of racial formations as the product not only of states and institutions and economic flows, but also of movements of resistance. It's social movements. I mean, and here's why, you know, I still want to argue with Charles. I know he got argued with a lot this morning.
No.
You know, that for Kant, the concept of the person, you know this, Elvira, you know, is formulated, but it really only becomes inclusive and universal to the extent we think it is because of social movements that forced it and gave it new meanings and gave it new instantiation and new practices. So those movements of resistance they have agency and they have power. They're not to be discounted. Even though we fail, even though we constantly fail, even though we win for a minute and then they find new ways to reformulate hierarchy and strategy and shift the deck chairs a little bit and things stay the same, there are still shifts in meanings and understandings and subject formation. So I want to have a top-down, bottom-up, and I want to have a more organic understanding of formations of identity than one would see it as simply a top-down discursive production that has total agency over it.
There was a question right there, and then in the leather jacket. Right, you had a question?
So this question goes towards the discomfort, or rather it's a comment perhaps. It's a sort of reflection of the worry that discomfort becomes a sort of secular mode of redemption. I now felt the discomfort, so now I don't have any more responsibilities because I paid my due. Sort of the worry about that, rather than discomfort as a mode of starting a critique, as a mode of entry into critique, rather than an end in itself which could be seen or experienced or sort of waved as a evidence that, oh, look, now I did my part.
Right, right. You have your discomfort card, so you're good or something, right?
Yeah, and I certainly did not mean it to be as an end. I mean, that's part of where the sort of experimentation, the versuchen comes in, right? It's sort of an ongoing thing. And again, that's always going to be the danger. Right, that you sort of suffering for suffering's sake, and then you look, I've done it, and then I'm done, right? And that's always going to be a danger, right? Because the discomfort has to come along with self-reflection and attempts at types of, I'm using the Nietzschean term self-mastery, but I've got to find a different term because it doesn't translate sort of very well. I even think the way that Nietzsche knows it, the way he used it sometimes, I'm like, yeah, that's not so good. But something like that, right? The self-reflection and attempts to deploy, in some sense, to grow and deploy different senses of oneself, right? So I think the way that you put it is the way that I would like to do it. But to say that then we can easily separate that off from the person who's using, oh, look, no, I suffered, right? I was in the Peace Corps for 2 years in West Africa. Done, right? As if that's sort of it, right? That's always going to be the danger. I don't see there's any way around it except visually.
Yeah, I just wanted to say that, in fact, both of you are very much in synergy with each other, because what I see is kind of a political project. Because if we're going to argue that central to what we're doing is she's what the disciplines do, you know, she's what power does, right, immediately justifies or engages in color blindness, and does not allow the, you know, the knowledge of the person that is arguing for racism that exists, that to operate and then begin to, I mean, anyone who's spoken to a dean would see that immediate, you know, not only this discomfort doesn't even wait a second before it triggers the discourse and to the response and to a knowledge, you know, regime that is backed with whiteness and colonial epistemology, as, you know, Martin is telling us. So I think that it's central to beginning to open up the discourse is to realize that, oh my God, these ideas sound really tricky, you know? Oh my God, these ideas sound like, you know, like where did they come from? You know, we have to be rewiring or, you know, for them to change knowledge behavior. So I think that there's something really exciting about thinking of, you know, what you're calling for as part of a political project that is necessary to just transform knowledge, you know, as we know it. So thank you for that.
Yes, if you want to study the cultural production of difference, you need to study Professor Arlene Davila's work, because she's, you know, really been one of the main contributors to really mapping that cultural production and all of its complexity. Thank you, Arlene. But I think what you said is true, that this idea of discomfort is resonating with people here. It is the moment we're in, I think, because of the demographic shifts that do have an impact on the academy. People now sort of know that by 2042 we're going to be a majority minority nation. You know, the white people will still be the largest plurality, but no longer a majority. And you hear in common speech all the time people say, we're going to be a third world nation, or we're already a third world nation. Florida's going to be a Spanish-speaking third world nation. I hear that from Metro Florida. So people realize this is coming. They don't know what it means. White people are in a state of discomfort and anxiety. And the problem is that it's not named as such. So we have this hysterical reaction. We have guns, right? It was a massing of guns because we're going to be, you know, white people are going to be under attack. So the hysteria around guns, the immigration debate, Obamacare and the healthcare debate, which is the redistribution of resources, concern about the redistribution of resources, when whites become one minority among others. And so naming it as such, bringing it to the surface, and you know, could be very therapeutic. I'm on board.
Yay! I hadn't even realized what I was doing. Between the two of you, this sounds fabulous. A lot of it. But I think that's it, right? And I think that you're right. There's a feeling of discomfort, no naming of discomfort, but a reaction, right? So, again, sorry to do this to you, or maybe not sorry, but Nietzsche talks about sort of active versus passive. And there's a way in which there's the passive, which I call the amoeba reaction, which is, ooh, don't like, gotta move away. Ooh, gotta get rid of it, right? So, I mean, I don't know how many times I've been to the APA and, you know, and heard people talk about, like, well, you know, all the women and people of color are getting all the jobs. And I'm always like, where are they? Where are they? I don't see them, right? And there's it's like this tipping factor, and I don't know what the number was, like three women of color, and all of a sudden it's tipped over to they're getting all the jobs and they're gonna take over and philosophy's going to hell in a handbasket without stopping and being like, what are you anxious about? Like, what's your empirical evidence here? What are you nervous about? Because empirically, there's not a huge change. But there is a change. But what is the change? And what are you worried about? What are you worried about losing? What can't you see that could possibly be gained by this? And why do you just want things to be the same? Right? And so, in some sense, I think you're right, sort of naming it, right, might stop at least or cause a pausing of some of the reactionary. Not with everyone, and perhaps not with most people, but a critical mass, right?
But on another level, I mean, on the one hand, you know, sociologists show us that whites tend to overestimate the number of people of color in a room,
yeah,
you know, by a factor of three or something. It's noticeable, you notice. So they constantly overestimate how many people of color in the room. So it's not a real discomfort, but on another way, it is a real discomfort, because they can see what's happening in the country, and the demographic shift is inevitable. So in a way, it's an anxiety with a real basis.
Right.
Right?
But I guess what I'm saying, it's almost like, so when the body has an allergic reaction, right, it's strawberries, and it goes, strawberries, strawberries, oh my God!
And I've been thinking about these different narratives, and so we have the narratives of transformation and enlightenment and grace and maybe justice and progress that Linda was challenging, and offering instead maybe narratives of inclusion, belonging, entitlement, so that you retell the story and the history so that there's more possibilities, maybe of heritage as well. There's narratives of meaning, narratives of coping and self-mastery. There's also narratives of revenge. I'm really big on those narratives. I like those a lot. And there's also a narrative about agency, autonomy, and power that philosophy uses that I, at least many of the members of underrepresented groups that I've talked to, they feel as though philosophy is a site where they can kind of get out of their social location a bit because they find that social location itself really hard to deal with all the time. And so there's a kind of autonomy that can sometimes come, and moreover, power. I mean, and it's good for revenge, because if you learn certain analytic tools and you come back at people with those analytic tools, it can be really powerful. So I'm not saying that's the right narrative, I'm not saying that's the best narrative, but it just seems to me that we need multiple narratives, right? And I'm not quite sure what recommends one of these narratives as the narrative, and I'm not saying you're suggesting that. I'm not saying that you're doing that. I actually applaud the proliferation of narratives, but I do think that there's one that is also quite powerful for certain groups of people and certain members of underrepresented groups, this autonomy, power, agency narrative that doesn't think about our historical locatedness and our context and all of that.
Well, I think if autonomy of power and agency is disconnected from history, it's not going to work. I think if because that would be sort of following a certain.
You get really high scores on the LSAT.
Yeah.
You do.
I mean, yeah.
And really high scores on it, and then you go to law school, and then
become a corporate lawyer.
No, not at all.
No, I mean, but seriously, Sally, I really do think that it will block self-understanding if we have a model of agency that's disconnected from historical location. I think history is non-negotiable. I think race is more about history than anything else, actually. We've sort of been able to set aside most of the biological content of race. I mean, there is still the population piece, but what we cannot set aside is the historical legacy and formation of racial categories and racism that has a very long,
I don't doubt that, but we're talking about philosophy and how we want to understand the activity of philosophy. And I completely agree that the activity of philosophy is a historical byproduct of a lot of very, very deeply problematic social practices and institutions. I have no doubt about that. But I also am a believer that some of the skills and talents and cognitive strengths that you get by doing philosophy are good. And and being able to spread that wealth, provide, and to have a narrative where these are good things that we ought to have, we ought to promote other people having, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. That's a narrative that can be very empowering to people and good for people of underrepresented groups to have those skills.
Well, on one level, I agree, because it's not about dumping the canon. I mean, we're both steeped in the canon, the canon, and the methods, and all of that. But on the other hand, I mean, this idea that we have this good that can spread to others is that's the Enlightenment narrative that I'm, wanting to, critique, that we have to root out, because that keeps us locked into a community of closure that sees us as teachers and not learners from. So I do think that there's tremendous resources in the Western.
But one of the
virtues
of certain kinds of philosophy is its openness to argument from anyone, anywhere, evaluated in its own terms.
That's not.
I know that's not. of ideals and such like that?
Well, to some extent, I think these things are not universal. So what we need is we need, you know, to do the non-ideal approach, as to follow Charles, what do we need now to help Western philosophy traditions, our traditions, change? We need that corrective of openness to learning from others. That's more important, because the missionary imperative of sharing our wealth with others, that's been going on for a while. That's pretty strong, and that feeds the vanguardist narrative that I'm very concerned about. So I think the corrective at this moment is the other one. And that's not to say it will always be the case, but in this moment, that's what we need.
You had a question?
I did. Thank you both for the talk. I enjoyed both immensely. My question is for Professor Scott. So we heard in Professor Haslinger's keynote yesterday, both in the discussion afterward and in the keynote itself, about this idea of creating disruption or disruptions. And as you were talking, Professor Scott, there seemed to be affinities or similarities between that concept and idea and the form of courage produced by something like Nietzsche pushing people toward a strong form of pessimism.
Mm-hmm.
And as we started to talk during the question and answer session, now it seemed like that language or concept or idea of disruption was coming up again. And I saw those affinities and similarities between the keynote yesterday and some of what you were saying, up until the point where you said there was this white colleague of yours for whom your talk and your form of disruption was not for. And it seemed in that moment like the kind of discomfort your talk or the form of discomfort that you were suggesting and lifting seemed to come apart from the kind of disruption that was discussed yesterday, because that seemed to be the kind of engagement that was aimed at engaging those individuals with certain beliefs, perhaps racist, or practices that produce, social practices that produce these forms of individuals directly. And so that came apart from me a little, even though there was, it seemed, some kind of conflation, as we were talking now, between the kind of agitation, I'm using this now, that you were suggesting and the kind of disruption we were talking about yesterday. So am I wrong to see that these are different, or was I right initially to feel as though there were affinities between the two?
I'm not sure I totally followed you, and
okay.
It just might be the time of day.
Okay.
So let me start talking and then sort of come back. So when I'm at this talk and I have sort of this white professor saying, well, like, you know, you didn't say anything for me. Right, you were talking about people of color, etc. And my point was that, let me take another step back. There's a way in which you go to an academic talk and you get the question, which is, oh, I see what you said, but you should have said something different. Like, they want you to talk about a different paper, right? Not really engaging the paper that you've just given, as if at any given moment when you give a paper, you should address something for everyone, right? So my talk, at the point I said, this is a talk, right, that's geared toward these communities of people, right? And that's what this is about, right? And there's a lot more that needs to be said for a lot of other communities, but this is what I'm talking about. So I felt like from him, he wanted me to do a different talk, which is, now, if racism is permanent, what's he supposed to do, right? He's feeling hopeless, how am I supposed to address him? And my response was sort of like, yeah, I'm not talking about you today. Not that that's not to be talked about, not that there's not something there, which is why I tried to add this thing sort of here at the end, but that wasn't it. And part of what happens, there's a way in which, in these spaces, it happens a lot in philosophy, so if you talk about people who are not at the center of philosophy, everyone who's not a white, straight, sort of, you know, wealthy man, then somehow, right, it doesn't count as much, right? And what I wanted to say was, what you're saying, that discomfort that you're feeling, I get it. I'm kind of happy you're feeling it. We're not talking about it now. Okay? That doesn't mean later on we can't talk about it and I can't try to extend it later on. But I felt like he was trying to, in some sense, co-opt, right, the room here. I mean, he's a professor. There are undergraduates, right, who are at a community college, who hopefully are going to a four-year college, who might sort of go into philosophy and do and sort of enter in this demographic change, and that he wasn't doing it, right? So I think that part of it is a way in which sort of whiteness gets centered. And so if there's sort of comfort around sort of being white and feeling sort of discomfort, now we need to talk about this now and you need to help me feel better, right? And that's where I did not want to sort of go into that then, because that was a, that's a different talk. That's a different thing. Am I addressing at all what you're saying,
you
or did
are.
I not?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so I think that's it, but that doesn't mean I want to dismiss it. And I didn't want to, and so I wanted to just say, and this is part of work, where's Paul? Right, I just wanted to say, you know what, I don't want to talk about you right now. I have like this amazing community of people who I can talk to, and I just thought I brought up some really juicy stuff here, and then you want to go, what about me, right?
I wonder the extent to which you're then putting him to one side is in itself then, maybe that's disruption too.
Yeah.
Here's an individual who is used, maybe not just as a professor, but particularly as a white professor in this case.
But he does have some Native American background.
But it's this concept of stepping back, you know, that has been used a lot in movies in New York, the need to step back, that we all need to do in certain, and to even to learn that sometimes to step back. I mean, not to step back every time, but sometimes to step back. I mean, that's a capacity some people need to cultivate.
Right. And part of what I love about Renier Torres is they use sort of, you know, standpoint theory to say, like, look, in the practices of people of color, they use the term people who are raised black, right? There's a lot you can learn about how this whole system works, right? But if all you're going to go is like, well, you consider me to be like part of that system, and I'm really not, you've missed out on an amazing educational opportunity, right? And so there's a way in which part of the stepping back is, wait, what can I learn here? They're not talking about me right now, but what can I learn here? And I just felt like he was like, no, we can't go on until you address me first, right? So in some sense, yes, part of it was a decentering, right? And that's disruptive, because normally be like, oh, you're feeling uncomfortable, let's talk about you, let's talk about this, right? And that's part of the reason why I've kind of resisted talking about whiteness, because I just felt like, oh my God, I live this all the time, now I'm supposed to theorize about it, right? But I do think that sort of talking about it and writing about it, I can't wait for it to come out, right, is a way then to do a type of disruption, because it's not sort of then normalizing it, right? It's saying like, no, it's not just normal. It's assumed to be, but and so by assuming it to be, then it becomes invisible. Let's make it visible. Let's put it in its sort of historical and social place. I just wasn't terribly interested in doing it at that time. And since I was my talk in my classroom, I mean, not my classroom, my talk, I just decided I don't want to talk. I said later on, I said, I'm more than happy to talk with you later on about this, but that's not what we're talking about now. So
we have like 5 minutes left. We have room for one or two questions.
What, can we just hear the questions and then respond?
Yeah, we could do that. Is that okay? You want to say your questions and then respond? We'll go here.
So a question for Linda. So I was kind of surprised. And I was surprised because what I thought wasn't addressed was the fact that philosophy, more than any other humanities or social science discipline, is masculine and white. And it seemed to me that your way of simply saying, well, it's got these other origins and it's got these other geography, was suggesting that that would be a sufficient response. So it strikes me as an alarming puzzle and an alarming kind of structure that keeps repeating itself. So there is, I guess I felt a kind of disappointment, because I take it that the gesture was meant, the geographical gesture, as a gesture of decentering and displacement. And what I felt is that didn't actually happen. That felt like more intellectual work. Just more intellectual history, more of what we do already, but you know, easily recuperable, and not the gesture that would throw the discipline into the kind of questioning that I think it is yet to undergo. Because at one level, and this way is, although I not in quite the way she intended, I kind of agree with Sally that there's resources of philosophy that are necessary for transformation, just not personally necessary, but conceptually, historically, structurally necessary. And the structure of the profession is excluding them still in ways that I don't feel the geographical displacement addresses. I think that was the concern.
Can I record that for a second and then
okay.
Your question?
Hi, thanks. I appreciate both discussions today. What I enjoyed was the kind of effort to somehow talk about a bridge theory and practice, and kind of that effort to say, well, the theory say this, but is this useful in reality? How do we do this? And also pairing that with the fact that, Professor Scott, you were talking about how, I mean, not just white people, but I think everyone should, you know, battle with it and sit with racial discomfort. In terms of relationship between police and communities, I feel like a lot of times we don't understand what the different perspectives are, but when we write them down, somehow, you know, we're able to kind of, you know, understand ourselves better and kind of write things down that we wouldn't have realized otherwise. Do you think that, you know, journaling kind of, for even police to kind of describe what was going through their head when you have situations of police brutality or other contexts in which there seems to be misunderstandings between police and communities, do you think that type of exercise in writing things down, should it be, you know, required? Do you think it would have value for, you know, police and for community members to hear what was going through their heads in that situation as a way of, you know, for the police and for the communities to all sit with their discomfort in situations like that?
And the last question, Ms. Sweater, could you just, for the sake of time, keep
sure.
It brief?
This is primarily directed towards Professor Scott. So I really like your idea of incorporating Nietzsche's strong pessimism. I think that's very important in the critical discourses where, you know, you have to exert a tremendous amount of effort to get even the most modest gain. So I think we also have a academic culture here in the United States that rewards conformity. So when you're asking students to think critically about their situation, you're basically asking them to take a risk and to forego some more immediate set of advantages. So I would think, or I'm inclined to think, that as pedagogues, we would most effectively be able to lead our students into confronting their discomfort by example. But oftentimes, even in the critical discourses, we're teaching texts that we're already comfortable with. So I just wanted to know if there's any realistic way of, I guess, foregoing the academic constraints of, you know, semester length and all the norms of evaluating students, things like that. If there's any way for us to not simply push them in the deep end of the pool that we already know how to swim in, but finding some common ground where we can flail about together, I guess.
Well, just very quickly, I'll respond to Jay. I mean, I think we're in agreement as usual, because I don't want to say simply that Western philosophy is not really Western and therefore it's okay. I do want to, the discipline isn't, I think the discipline isn't crisis. I think it doesn't understand and doesn't have a correct articulation of the crisis that it's in, what the causes of it are, what the solutions to it are. So I don't know. I guess I'm more down than you or Sally, though, in terms of I don't think the resources are there in the analytic tradition in particular, but also in the continental tradition to do the kind of reflexiveness that we need to do, the material reflexiveness. So I think we need a both and strategy. We do need to give a more correct accounting of what gets called Western philosophy and what the canon is and how it was formed. So we do need to, and that will have some deconstructive effects. We have to guard against the deconstruction saying, oh, well, you can't talk about the West at all because of that. I think we still can, because we can talk about dominant narratives. But we need a both and of also recognizing, critiquing, and developing the tools for a more effective, reflexive critique of the locatedness of Western philosophy that links its lack of reflexivity to its colonial historiography. That's what I would say.
So let me try to sort of address two questions sort of really fast, because we need to leave. I think there's food in the back. So it is 7 o'clock, so I'm going to talk really fast. I'm from Chicago, so I can handle this. So in terms of bridging theory and practice, I'm digging this idea of like journaling, telling the story, right? I don't know how that works on a practical level. Like, I mean, we can enforce that. So I'm just going to put that one over there. But it seems like in some sense we do have this. So I think about different of where the goal is not so much to find someone guilty or not, because at that point the way that you sort of win is you tell as little as possible, right? But in some sense of like, let me tell you everything that how I was feeling and what was going on, as a way of sort of getting this out and working through. I mean, I think therapeutically, I think that sounds great. How that works on a practical level in terms of getting sort of police officers to do that, I don't know. But it's in terms of a grassroots way of thinking about it, I think it's not a bad way. You could think of sort of the truth and reconciliation sort of processes that they have as a way of getting people to tell stories that don't necessarily then decide guilt or innocence. And that moves away from some of the legalistic sort of gagging that sort of happens. In terms of pedagogy of racial discomfort, I mean, you know, no semesters, et cetera. Oh God, the deans, what would they say? But I think that people in some sense already do that, right? And people have written about the different ways, even within the constraints of a classroom and a 15-week semester or a 10-week quarter, to try to find ways of using philosophy to engage in this type of disruption. And there are resources, I think, out there for that. But we need to have more of that. We need for people to be writing about how they do that in their classroom, right? Because what we have before us is read a bunch of text and then just talk about it and then write a paper isn't so great. I mean, one quick thing that I do because we have to stop is, and this is so simple and it's so ridiculous, but for many students it's kind of profound, and I have a former student in here, so now I'm not going to make eye contact because she's going to be like, you didn't do that. But there's a way in which getting them to read a text, I'm like, okay, give me an example, a real life example. I don't want a brain in a vat. I want a real life example where you've seen this sort of happening, right? And getting them to explain the theory in terms of the real life example, it deepens their understanding of the theory, helps them to be critical of it, right? But then also helps them to see like, oh, this is not just about sort of these sort of figures out there, but real people in real lives, right? So using in some sense a type of narrative, and this is just give me an example, right? That helps to sort of bring it in life and then helps students sort of engage it in a different way and often feeling uncomfortable about it. So that was good.
All right, thank you so much. I encourage you to eat and drink.